Okay, good evening. We're going to get rolling as people find seats, last few folks. I want to welcome you on behalf of the Freeman Spogli Institute for International Studies here at Stanford. My name is Catherine Stoner, and I am the other political scientist here at Stanford who also works on Russia. Actually, there's more than just two of us. There are many of us. And I am the sometime co-author of some of Mike's books and articles, although he does pretty well without me. He's rather productive without my help. I'm also a senior fellow and the deputy director of the Freeman Spogli Institute for International Studies, where our speaker this evening, Ambassador and Professor Michael McFaul, serves as the director. So it's my pleasure and my sincere honor to introduce Michael to you this evening. Although at Stanford in particular, Mike is a man who really needs very little introduction. But just in case you don't know Mike or his work, I'll give you a brief intro. Mike has a long and distinguished history at Stanford, where he first came as an undergraduate from Montana in the autumn quarter of 1981. And if you get a few beers in him, you'll find out that he was housed in Ujamaa that first year. It was at Stanford where he met his wife, Donna, who's joined us this evening and to whom he was married a little more than 10 years later. Mike was a BA double major in Slavic languages and international relations. He co-termed in Russian and East European studies, so he also got an MA here, graduating in 1986. His first trip to Russia, as he tells you in his highly acclaimed new book and long anticipated, especially for those of us who work with him, was in 1983 as a sophomore here at Stanford. And the photo of him holding up a poster that says Russia or bust in the middle of this book as he headed off to the Soviet Union for the first time is alone, let me assure you, worth the price of the book. Mike went on to Oxford after Stanford to receive a DPhil in international relations, and he wrote on liberation movements in Southern Africa, and in particular, the influence and intervention of the Soviet Union in the Southern African context. But even a dissertation on Africa led Mike to the Soviet Union as a researcher, which is actually where I first met him, at a discussion section at Moscow State University, where we talked or debated democracy with our host there. And eventually, Mike became an activist, helping to support the efforts of NGOs like the National Democratic Institute. And he also opened the Carnegie Endowment of International Peace's Moscow office in supporting Russia's early democratic stirrings. Mike then came back to Stanford as an assistant professor of political science in 1995 and to the Hoover Institution, where he is now the Peter and Helen Bing Senior Fellow. And finally, to the Freeman Spogli Institute, where he has served as director of the Center on Democracy Development and the Rule of Law, and the deputy director of the Freeman Spogli Institute, again, a position I now hold, so I feel like my trajectory is quite good. And since 2015, he has been the director of the Freeman Spogli Institute. Mike's first trip to the Soviet Union, as I mentioned, in 1983 as a sophomore, would be the first of hundreds of visits to the Soviet Union and then Russia, culminating, of course, in his arrival in Moscow as President Barack Obama's ambassador in January of 2012, a post he held until March of 2014, although, as he is always careful to note, and I can feel his presence here, he got out before Crimea was taken by Putin, so that didn't happen on his watch. Prior to that, Mike served as a close advisor to Obama during his campaign, flying with him on O Force One, and eventually was allowed to fly on Air Force One as special assistant to the president and senior director for Russia and Eurasia at the National Security Council from 2009 to 2012. All of these experiences are recounted in his highly anticipated and now, we can safely say, highly acclaimed new book, From Cold War to Hot Peace, an American Ambassador in Putin's Russia. But Mike is the rare ambassador who is also an academic, as the book explains, and who has spent his lifetime as both activist and researcher. Before he went into government, he was undoubtedly the best political scientist writing on Russia in a generation, perhaps rivaled only by a prior generation's great scholar, policy maker George Kennan, who also, of course, served as U.S. ambassador to the Soviet Union. McFaul, like Kennan, is the rare academic who has also successfully bridged this often too wide gap between policy and academia. I will close by noting that it is a testament to Mike's abilities as a diplomat that he has managed to get no fewer than 4 secretaries of state, 2 Democrats, 2 Republicans, 3 women, 1 man, to provide enthusiastic blurbs about his book on the back cover. None of the books that we've done together have even a single secretary of state blurbing them, but maybe the next one. So it's my pleasure to introduce my friend and my colleague and our former ambassador to Russia from the United States, Michael McFaul, and I urge you to buy his fascinating book at the end of the talk this evening.
Wow. Thank you, Catherine. After that introduction, we should just go to questions, right? She summarized my life. That was so nice of you. Thank you all for coming. I know I'm competing with Warriors, first game of the series, so I know that you really want to talk about Russia. That honors me. I'd actually rather be watching the Warriors right now. But I'm thrilled you're here. This book means a lot to me. It's a tragedy, as I'm going to tell you in a few minutes, a tragedy about U.S.-Russian relations, a tragedy about Obama's attempt to reset relations with Russia. I actually just got a chance to present the book to him last week, so we went over our stories, because he's writing his own book. Thankfully, our stories overlap. I was a little nervous about that he might have had a different memory of it. And it's a somewhat of a tragedy of my own arc, of my own life, starting out here as a kid and having some ideas about Russia and ending in places that I didn't want to do it. So what I'm going to do tonight, and this is the first time I've ever tried to do this, and it may fail, and then I will correct, and I'll get it right by the time I get to Harvard on Wednesday. I'm going to try to weave the personal and the analytic. I'm going to lean on the analytic, because this is Stanford, after all. But I want to talk, bounce back and forth, especially to bring a little bit of Stanford into the story, because we're at Stanford today. As Catherine said, I came to Stanford as a 17-year-old kid. I first got my interest, though, in Montana, and I want to give Montana some credit. Sometimes we're thought of in certain ways. The red state, the flyover state. But junior year of high school, I joined the debate team. I actually joined the debate team to get an easy A, by the way, because I didn't like to write back then. And the debate topic that year was U.S.-Russian, how to improve U.S. trade policy. And my debate partner and I, we ran what's called a squirrely case, if there's any debaters out there. You're nodding, right? Squirrely means obscure, strange, that nobody has any data on. And we ran a case saying we should repeal the Jackson-Vanik trade amendment to the 1974 Trade Act as a way to increase trade to the Soviet Union. So it wasn't at Stanford, actually, that I started my interest in the Soviet Union. It was in Montana. But fall quarter of my freshman year, I registered into 2 classes that changed my life, and Stanford really did change my life. First year Russian and poli-sci 35. Anybody have poli-sci 35 before? With Steve Krasner? I know you did. Anybody else? It's called something else now, poli-sci 3 or something. But those 2 classes I took because I was scared. I was scared of the Cold War. There's enough gray hair in this room that you know what I mean, but there's enough young people here to remind you it was a scary time. And I had a theory that if we could just engage with the Russians, we called them the Soviets then, and get to know each other, we could reduce tensions in U.S.-Russian relations. So that was my initial theory. Played with it for a while. And sophomore year, there it is, that's a photo. Wasn't sure I should include that in the book. My publishers wanted to. There I am. Sophomore year. I see my sophomore son is here. Cole, thanks for coming, Cole. That's what I looked like back then. Actually, I had just gotten a haircut. My hair was a lot longer than that back then. And imagine, so my sophomore year, summer, most people go to Florence. They go to Paris. They go to London, to our campuses there. That's most certainly where my girlfriend went. She went to Florence. I went to Moscow in 85. Shows you who's the smart one in our family. But I was going because I'd never been abroad before. Never been abroad. And imagine that phone call to my mother in Montana, who, by the way, thought California was a communist state. Bunch of hippies, and I'm going to come back some communist. And sure enough, I came back with long hair, and I wanted to go to that evil empire. That's what Ronald Reagan called the Soviet Union back in 1983. And there I am at the Bozeman Airport on my way to Leningrad. Took a long ways to get there. So that's why I went. That's why I got interested. And so for me, the end of the Cold War was a glorious moment. And I want to emphasize that. This was good news. I am not part of this revisionist history that somehow this was a bad deal for America. And Russians, notice I say Russians, plural, Gorbachev there, but all these people too. If you look hard, you can see me. I am actually at that demonstration. They were our partners in ending this Cold War. They too wanted a world where we were going to be closer together, at least some of them, and actually several hundred thousand of them. And also Ukrainians, and also Georgians, and Lithuanians, and Latvians, and Estonians. If you look hard, you can see those flags in this meeting too. And so I want to remind you of that period, because it's easy to forget. Most certainly Putin wants you to forget about it. He wants you to think that we've always been in this confrontational relationship, but that is definitely not the way it was in the late 80s and early 90s. And so just to remind you of that, and then to remind you of the horrible moment we're in today in terms of our confrontation with Russia. 2 years ago, the then prime minister said, we're just like it's the Cold War. Notice he invokes 1962. Just a couple weeks ago, of course, on Twitter, our president said it's even worse than the Cold War, our current moment today. Now, we could have a semantic debate about if it's worse or better, and if it's hot peace versus the Cold War versus hot peace. And, you know, I'm happy to do that in questions. I use this phrase hot peace deliberately to echo the past, because some of the things are similar. History doesn't repeat itself, but it rhymes. I think that is true here. But some of the aspects of the hot peace are worse, more dangerous, more frightening, even than periods of the Cold War. We used to have a big quantitative arms race. Now we have a qualitative one that I think is more scary, actually, in some ways, than the late era of the Soviet era in the Cold War. It's great. We don't have communism versus capitalism, but Putin is fighting an ideological struggle against the West, the decadent, illiberal West. That's the way he describes it. Better or worse? I don't know. And some things that we thought were over, that we'd gotten rid of. Annexation. You know, for most of the decades of the Cold War, annexation wasn't part of this struggle back and forth. Now it's back. And on our side, never in the history of the Cold War has so many people been on a sanctions list. The chief of staff of the Kremlin never was on the sanctions list during the Cold War. And it's gotten so bad that I'm on the sanctions list. I no longer can travel to Russia. I'm in good company. George Kennan was the last former ambassador to be put on that list. And I just saw his daughter two days ago in D.C. She's got a new book coming out herself. And she said, welcome to the club, Mike. I was on that list for a long time. And keep the faith. You might get off later. But I think we would all agree that this is a confrontational moment in U.S.-Russian relations. And for me, I want to add the adjective tragic confrontation. So what I want to do is I just want to explain this photo. These photos, actually. What happened? What happened? How did we go from that moment to this moment? By the way, I was at that meeting. That's in Los Cabos, Mexico, of all strange places to have a summit. Flew there from Moscow. And let me tell you, the meeting was much worse than that photo. Much worse. All right, so for the next 15, 20 minutes, I want to explain that. What happened? And then I want to take your questions. And when we get to questions, I want to be clear. I'm talking pretty analytically now, but I want to make sure we can talk about anything. We can talk about all the other chapters in the book, some of the lighter chapters. I've heard from that some of you already read lots of the book. Wow, that is great. please recommend it to your friends, your wives, your cousins. Father's Day's coming, don't forget. So we can talk about the two-step, we can talk about Obama's jump shot. It's not as good as he thinks it is. But here's what I want to keep with the kind of more conceptual piece as I work through these explanation of this. What the hell happened? How did we go from this? All right? And I'm going to oversimplify, but I think there are three big arguments out there, theories, if you will, explanations, and I want to walk you through all three of them. My bluff, for those of you who worked in the Pentagon, you know what that is, bottom line up front, is that the third explanation does most of the work here, but the first two are part of it. So let me walk you through it and end with that. All right, first one, structure of the international system. This is poli-sci 35, structural realism, if you remember all that. And this is an argument that focuses on power. Power between the states, balance of power in the international system. And what you see here, this is just some history racing through 1205, 1220. You can get the idea. What's going on here is some countries are getting more powerful, other countries are getting weaker, and as a result, there's confrontation, and at times, borders change, right? It's going to take a long time before Crimea gets to Russia, by the way. But we're not going to go through the whole map that way. And so this theory says what we're seeing today is just normal great power politics. It goes on for hundreds, thousands. If you go all the way back to Thucydides, you know, thousands of years of history, nothing new under the sun here, right? Russia was weak, Soviet Union collapsed. Now Russia's back, it has power, and they're just behaving like a great power again. Nothing new under the sun, and by the way, that's how all great powers, including the United States, act. And I want to say first, part of this theory, part of this explanation is true. Power matters in the international system, and power matters for the story in my book. I'm a little worried to say this. I usually pause here and now say, anybody from Moldova? Good. Usually, I'm worried there might be somebody from Moldova here tonight, given that we're at Stanford. And I love Moldova. That came off wrong. I love Moldova. I went there with the vice president in 2011, and he spoke before 50,000 people, which is probably the largest audience he's ever had, because, you know, he didn't get that chance during his vice presidential time. They loved him. So don't get me wrong. I love Moldova. I urge you to go. But we're not talking about Moldova today because Moldova does not have the power to threaten Europe to redraw borders. And, you know, weak states sometimes create problems for the United States, as we learned tragically on September 11th. But we're talking about Russia tonight, and I write about Russia in the book because Russia has power to do things in the world, to annex territory, to support people like Assad, and to intervene in our elections, right? So power matters. But there's two buts I want to focus on. One, I can think of some great powers that rose up and didn't annex territory of their neighbors, that didn't threaten the international liberal order. Japan, Germany comes to mind. You know, if I'm feeling good, I might even add Poland to this list. Poland's way more powerful today, and yet nobody's worried about them invading their neighbors. And even China, which I put there as a teaser, this notion that it's inevitable that we're going to have a war or conflict with China because of its rising power, I don't believe that. I think other variables come into play, and I don't want to get ahead of our skis in predicting that. But I want you to focus on it's not inevitable. There must be something more to the story in order to have a complete picture of why we're in this confrontation with Russia today. And the second reason I feel even more strongly about that is because when I was ambassador, the number one project for Putin was creating something that most of you haven't heard of. I see some Ukrainians here, so there are people that know it. This is a weird crowd. I don't usually talk to, you know, there's a lot of people here that know a lot of things about international relations. But it's something that most of you have never heard of. It's called the Eurasian Economic Union. It was his answer to the EU. He wanted to gather up all the countries of the Soviet Union and be kind of a bulwark against the EU. And critical, absolutely critical to making that thing work was to have Ukraine join. He had Belarus, he had Kazakhstan, but when I was ambassador, we were writing our memos, you know, focus on this, you know, nobody read those memos. They're called cables, right? I don't know why they're called cables. We send emails, but I guess that's left over from a time earlier. Trying to say, people, this is the most important thing to Putin. Nobody paid attention. But for him, the focus was on Ukraine. And here's why. Anybody buy anything with a label on the back of it, notice I said that, made in Russia, сделано в России, here in the U.S.? What'd you buy? Caviar? Are you sure it was legal? A lot of illegal caviar. All right, so we can buy caviar here. Okay, that's one. Anything else? That's not really made in Russia. That's packaged from fish in Russia. How about products made in Russia? Vodka? Okay, all right, you can buy vodka. I've been down to Menlo Park at that Bev and Bo or whatever it's called. You can buy beer, Baltica Siem. I would not encourage it. It's not very good. I buy it every now and then for nostalgic purposes. But my point is, there's not a lot of made in Russia goods sold here because Russia doesn't make a lot of goods that we want to buy here. But in Ukraine, there are a lot of consumers that buy Russian goods. And so back then, to get Ukraine to join was key to making this thing whole. So if that's your goal, that's your main strategic goal, how is it that you would invade Ukraine, seize Crimea, guaranteeing, I think, forever that Ukraine will never join what was back then your biggest project? To answer that question, we need some more proximate variables, right? We need something closer to the events that happened. All right, argument number two. It's all our fault. We Americans, we screw up everything everywhere, and we're responsible for everything everywhere. And here's, this is another instance of U.S. foreign policy screwing everything up. So we lectured them about markets and democracy. I was part of that crew in the early 90s, as Catherine said. We then expanded NATO. We bombed Serbia. We invaded Iraq. We allegedly supported color revolutions in Georgia 2003, Ukraine 2004, and so Putin just had to push back. Finally, he just said, I'm not gonna take it anymore. I'm pushing back on all this imperialistic, hegemonic activity of the United States in the 90s and 2000s. And I wanna underscore, all of these things happened. These are facts. And most of them, all of them actually, created tensions in U.S.-Russian relations. That is all true. But in between all of this and our current moment of confrontation, there was an interregnum of cooperation. We called it the reset. And during this period, after all that stuff happened, we sat down first with President-elect Obama. President-elect Obama, by the way, was the first person to use the word reset in December 2008. And we told him about that history, and he said, come on, man. Like, I'm the new guy. Like, why do we have to worry about something that happened in ancient history to get in the way of our interests? And he would turn to me and say, do the Russians want Iran to get a nuclear weapon? And I'd say, no, Mr. President, they don't. So why can't we work together on that? Do the Russians want terrorists to win in Afghanistan? Well, no. Well, why can't we work together on that? What about nuclear weapons? Don't they want to reduce them? We said yes. And so over the course of this policy review, by the way, we did a very thorough interagency policy review. Not a lot of evidence of that happening in Washington these days, but we, for better for ill, we were joking about it just last week. We were process-oriented folks, and we came up with this idea, pretty simple idea, that let's work with Russia where our interests overlap, in what the president called win-win outcomes, at least the difficult issues. Let's not link them. We deliberately did not do linkage to other kinds of issues in U.S.-Russian relations. And there we go. There we are, off to the races. Fourth day of office for both of us. He's about to call President Medvedev for the first time to kind of lay out this argument about the reset. I was going to make a joke about his hair, but I'm not going to do that. That's not fair. I walked out, by the way, after that, and there's still all the Bush folks and Secret Service folks work for Bush. They told me you're not supposed to touch the desk. I don't know if that's true, but nobody briefed me about that before. All right. I'm not going to go through this list in detail. I want you to read the book. There's chapters on it. But I want to remind you that we got some big things done in this period. Wasn't just holding hands and singing kumbaya and wanting a better relationship. Let's have a piece of chocolate cake and everything, we're good and we love each other as friends. No, It was about really concrete things that we thought were in America's national interest, and we assumed that the Russians, this is President Medvedev, would not sign up to them if they were not in Russia's national interest. So this was a great day for me. This is a fantastic day. We're in Prague. They signed the START agreement, reducing by 30% the number of nuclear weapons in the world allowed in each country. This was then a fun day, too. This was the day it was ratified at the end of the year, the last day of the before the Senate winter break. We went down. You know, I watched the vice president preside as we got the 72 votes. I remember very vividly watching Senator McCain walk down the hall, and he had his finger like this, and then he got up and he went like that, and he voted against us. But he's a good guy, and he was very good to me, by the way, throughout my entire career, including as U.S. ambassador. And again, you know, I love my job here at Stanford. I'm grateful. You know, this is paradise, and I'm going to be here for the rest of my life. But some days here at Stanford, the years kind of blur. You know, like what did I do in 2003, you know? I published an article in the Journal of Democracy. I see Larry Diamond here. Maybe I did that, but I can't remember which one. And even in government is really hard to do anything. You know, most people just be. They're just, I am a deputy assistant secretary, or I was a deputy to the deputy assistant secretary. Okay, it's so hard to do anything. It's like, you know, the interagency process, you work through it, and you finally get an agreement, and then the other side gets a vote. The Russians get a vote. The Chinese get a vote. The Iranians got a vote. 2010, we did something big. As the vice president said, that is a big word that begins with F, deal. I just can't say words like that. And I felt, you know, that's pretty good. Like, that's what I did in 2010. Got rid of 30% of the nuclear weapons in the world. You know, what did you do? That's a big deal. That's a big deal. Remember, that was a big deal. And we did a bunch of other things that people forget about. We opened up a supply route to Afghanistan through Russia and Central Asia that at the peak of it, I was kind of in charge of it at the White House, accounted for around 60% of our supplies going into Afghanistan. And I think for the first time ever, please, if you know that I'm wrong, correct me during questions. I think for the first time since World War II, American soldiers were flying through Russian airspace. Think about that. That's about as close to a strategic partnership as you get. And we did that, just so you understand the importance of it, because we needed to reduce the dependency that we had on Pakistan, where when I came into the White House, over 90% of our supplies went through Pakistan. As you may recall, we had an idea to take the war effort into Pakistan from time to time, including very dramatically on a day in 2011 when we killed Osama bin Laden. We would not have been able to do that operation had we not reduced this dependence. In fact, the day before I was in the Oval Office, I was summoned to the Oval Office on a Saturday by one of my bosses, Dennis McDonough, and he said, "Hey, man, we got to do some business today with Kazakhstan." And I was like, "Why today? It's Saturday. You know, I just spent a lot of quality time with you for the last 5 days." And he said, "You know, get down here. We got to do this. An enhancement to NDN." And I was giving the argument, "Well, you're not understanding the domestic politics of Kazakhstan, Dennis. This is not the right time to do this. I propose that we do this, you know, 6 weeks later after some election." And he said, "I'm really appreciative, Mr. Professor." You don't want to be called a professor when you're working at the White House. "I'm really appreciative of all your intimate knowledge of Kazakhi politics. But we are doing this deal today. Get your ass down here. The president is going to be calling Nazarbayev." And the next day was the operation against Osama bin Laden. Third, Iran sanctions. I'll go faster here. Most comprehensive set of sanctions that we've ever had in the history of the UN Security Council led to what I think was a terrific deal with the Iranians that unfortunately our president just tore up last week. Don't do that without Russian cooperation. And then this last category, it's important for students here to remember the non-events in history. They get written out pretty easily. But for me, the scariest day by far working at the Security Council was in the spring of 2010. President Bakiyev was overthrown in Kyrgyzstan. 100 people died. 300,000 ethnic Uzbeks fled into neighboring Uzbekistan. And it felt like we were on the verge of an ethnic civil war in Kyrgyzstan. And you may not think that's a big deal, but I just mentioned NDN, the Manas Air Base. We changed the name to make it more accommodating for the Russians back in 2009, called it a transit center, with a lot of airplanes there. Over 95% of our troops went through Manas on their way to Afghanistan. So this was scary, and it felt like another color revolution. Remember, I mentioned those earlier? But this time, it didn't end in acrimony between our two countries, because Medvedev and Obama got on the phone and said, both of our countries don't have an interest in this thing blowing up. Let's work together to resolve it. And you never read about this horrible genocidal war because we helped to defuse it. All right, I'll go quicker through the results here. I just like to remind people, this is just 5 years ago. This is just, it's in Colorado Springs, Russians and Americans jumping out of airplanes, doing counter-terrorist training together. We did a bunch of economic things. For most people, these seem like small, but every one of those boxes represents literally thousands of hours of my life. That visa regime, that was a negotiation with the Russians and DHS. That was really hard. But we had everything moving in the right direction on this front. We even brought Dmitry Medvedev to Stanford. There he is, speaking at Stanford, because he wanted to build a Silicon Valley-like thing. And we said, in order to do it, you have to have a university. It's called Skoll Tech now. These were some pretty good days of cooperation. And it showed even in society. Over 60%, roughly 60% of Russians had a positive view of the United States back then at the peak of the reset. And almost a similar number of Americans had a positive view of Russia back in the peak of the reset. And I want to remind you, all of these things happened, everything I just described, happened after NATO expansion, after the Orange Revolution, after the Iraq War. In fact, I was on every single phone call with the president, with Medvedev and Putin, during this period, until I went to become ambassador, and at most meetings. And NATO expansion never came up once, not once. It was a solved issue, for better or for ill. Our Republican friends criticized this, it was a solved issue, but it was not, none of these issues were a drama in our relationship. So to get an A in McFaul's class, and I know some of my students are here, you cannot cite those earlier causal variables as an explanation for today's confrontation without having an explanation for that period of cooperation. That makes no sense. You can't say we're fighting today about NATO expansion when we had a period when nobody was thinking about NATO expansion. And that leads me to my third and last argument, which is, I think, the heart of the matter, Russian domestic politics. And here, there's lots of variables, and they're in the book. You know, please buy the book and all the nuance that's in there. But there are two really important events that happened here. And by the way, both of these events happened between the time that I had signed up to be ambassador and agreed that I would do the job and my arrival. So I want you to think about that as we go through some other slides, right? These things happened after I had agreed to go out to serve as ambassador. One, in September 2011, Putin decides that he wants to be president again. He's tired of Medvedev being president. I'm going to tell you more about that in a minute. And in September 2011, they do this little switcheroo, and he starts running for president. The election was in March of 2012. And, you know, we got to know Putin fairly well during this period, not maybe as well as I would have liked. But what we came to learn, that these two gentlemen actually had rather radically different worldviews. In fact, the day this happened, actually, it wasn't the day, it was two or three days later, September, I went in to see the president. It was about something else. I can't remember exactly what. And after the meeting, he pulled my arm. He kind of pulled me back into the Oval Office and said, well, what do you think? What are we going to do about this? And I initially kind of gave him the party line, which is Putin's the big dog. He's the big decision maker. That's what everybody said at the time, right? They all said to us, you're naive dealing with Medvedev. Putin's always making the decision. So I kind of repeated that. And I said, of course, your personal capital you built up with Medvedev, we're not going to be able to use that. But, you know, we'll get on with what we have to do. We don't get to choose their leaders. And he looked at me and he said, come on, man. You don't really believe that. And I said, no, I don't really believe that. Things are going to change. We're going to have a lot harder time with this guy because I have known Putin since the spring of 1991. And I wrote my first article warning the world about Putin in March 2000. And of course, I knew that things were going to get more complicated. And fundamentally, if Medvedev is willing to see win-win outcomes with the United States. In fact, in that signing ceremony I showed you, when we were in Prague, he did his remarks in Russian, and right at the end, he turned and he smiled to Obama, and he said in English, Barack, this is a win-win outcome. And Barack kind of smiled because that was a phrase he had used a lot of times. Putin doesn't see the world that way. He sees the world in zero-sum terms, plus two for America, minus two for Russia. He'll cooperate in the margins, but fundamentally, he sees us as a competitor on a good day, an enemy on a bad day. And in particular, this third one is the one I want to focus on just for a little bit. He thinks that America uses overt and covert power to overthrow regimes we don't like. And guess what? There's a lot of empirical data to support that hypothesis about American power over the last 70 years. That's true. That's happened. We tried to make an argument that we're different. In fact, this is the first meeting between President Obama and Prime Minister Putin. I was sweating bullets at this first because I'm a note taker, and as my family knows, I can't read my own handwriting, and that becomes the record. Two, the meeting was supposed to last for an hour, and 55 minutes into the meeting, the president had not spoken because Putin had a big speech he had to give, and I was supposed to read it out to the press. And I'm thinking, what am I going to tell them? Like, for 55 minutes, you know, my guy said nothing? That's not a headline we wanted. Thankfully, it went for 3.5 hours, and we had lots to say. But it went back and forth. The essence of this meeting was the following. Putin wanted to lecture the new guy about all the mistakes that the Bush administration had made. And he had a long speech. He had many, many instances. And he comes prepared for meetings. Note to President Trump, he comes prepared for meetings. You better, too, if you're going to do business with this guy. And he walked through the litany of mistakes. And when we got to Iraq, he said, you guys were idiots. You don't understand the Middle East. Look at the mess you've made. And Obama responded to him. He said, you're right. I agree. And Putin was like, hey, whoa, I'm playing the Russians. You're playing the Americans. You're not, you know, those are my talking points. He didn't say that, but he like kind of looked at him a little funny. And Obama said, well, you may have forgotten, but or maybe you didn't know, but well before it was popular, I was against that war. And that was kind of interesting for Putin. He's like, whoa, maybe this guy is different. He talks different. He looks different. Maybe this is a break with the past. And as we walked out to the cars, you know, as they're kind of bantering back and forth, I got the sense that Putin had an open mind. Well, maybe we're going to have a way to work with these folks. Go work with Medvedev. You know, been there, done that. I'm not going to do another reset with you guys. I did that with Bush. It didn't work out. But go knock yourself out. Work with President Medvedev, and we'll see what happens. 2 years later, lots of evidence in Putin's view that Obama was just like Bush. And I want to be clear as I go through this. Egypt, Libya, in fact, let me say a little more about Libya. In all of these instances in the year 2011, what you're going to see here with some slides, massive demonstrations against autocratic regimes. We did nothing to start them. Nothing. We reacted to them. And I was still working at the White House at the time. You know, in many ways, these were a distraction from the bigger things we were trying to do. But when we got to Libya in particular, we felt that we were on the verge of genocide in Benghazi. And we wanted to take military action. But because Obama believed so strongly in international institutions, he said, as a precondition, we have to get a Security Council resolution. And in March 2011, we did that. I was at the meeting with Medvedev in Moscow, this time with the vice president, when he said, you guys are right. These regimes are corrupt, and we have to be on the right side of history. And for the first time ever in Soviet or Russian history, they abstained on that Security Council resolution, 1970 and 1973, authorizing the use of force in Libya. And in many ways, as I have a whole chapter on this in the book, that was the height of cooperation in the reset, right? Imagine Russians and Americans agreeing to use force inside the sovereign country of a dictator to save lives. But it was also the end of the reset. Because 2 days later, Putin said publicly, not just privately, Medvedev made a mistake. He should never have done that. And I think that's when he decided, this guy's been drinking too much reset Kool-Aid. I'm going to have to come back and take over. He's too close to the West. And it continued. Syria. This is the longest chapter in my book. It's the most tragic because of the mistakes we made. But I want you to get to feel, right? This is the 2011. Demonstrations are happening all over the Middle East. And then we get to the last month of 2011. It happens in Russia. Second major factor here. Putin coming back, demonstrations. And what happened here? False, you know, normal election, falsified under kind of normal levels. We met, 5%, 6%. That's normal for Russia back then. That was our assessment. But that wasn't their assessment. With their smartphones, with VKontakte, with Twitter, Facebook, they captured the evidence of falsification, spun it around, and then 50, then 500, then 100,000, and eventually 200,000 people went onto the streets of Moscow, first to say, give us back our vote, and then later, as what happens when you get that many people together, they started to criticize the Putin regime. Russia without Putin became one of the cheers. And remember, the last time that many people were on the streets of Moscow, 20 years earlier, the year the Soviet Union collapsed. The event that Putin called the greatest tragedy of the 20th century. Think about that, pretty tragic century, that's what he thought. So seeing those crowds meant that he needed a new game plan for how to deal with those crowds. His first reaction was actually anger. I saw him one time at a meeting and he's like, those people, those kids, they called them the creative class. It's like, I made them rich. You know, I brought them off their knees. They have all their fancy iPhones and laptops and stuff because of me. How could they have betrayed me? He was upset at them. And if you look at the demographics, it was these young people. But then his next reaction was fear. Didn't want a replay of 1991. And so he began to create this argument to undermine their legitimacy, to call them the marionette, you know, the puppets of the West. And to do so, he had to revive us, the West, and the United States as the enemy, to say that we were controlling these people. We were sending them money. America, Obama, and me. Now, I want to say for the record, this started before I got there. I get to Moscow in January 2012. Just for the record, you know, I didn't cause all this mess. He started saying these things well before I showed up. That's Vladimir Putin speaking. But when I did show up, I became the poster child for this kind of criticism. In fact, one of the campaign folks that worked for him, he said to me, somebody I've known for a long time, he said, Mike, because remember, Putin's running for re-election right now, right? Still the election. He said, Mike, you are like manna from heaven. You have just showed up right at the right time because you look like an American, you talk like one, and you've been writing all this stuff about democracy and revolution. Don't take it personally when we go after you, right? Don't take it personally that we're going to take some shots at you. It'll all settle down after the election, but, you know, bear with us. We're going to use you. By the way, Navalny, the person that I'm accused of creating here, I tried to joke one time on Twitter. He went to Yale for 6 months, and they said, you know, McFaul had orchestrated this secret training program for him, and I tweeted out, how would a Stanford guy ever send anybody to Yale? You got the joke. They didn't get the joke on Twitter. And during this period, I wasn't joking when I said I became the poster child. I literally became the poster child. This is a calendar that was put out in 2012 in English and Russian. All the other months of the year are various opposition leaders, McFaul's girls, as they were called. And then you've heard a little bit about disinformation, fake news, something we've now come to understand that the Russians are pretty good at in our system. Well, several years earlier, they were also doing that, a little cruder back then. It's gotten much more sophisticated now. For those that don't read Russian, on the left is a poster put up at a bus station, and it says, May 6th, this is 2012, the political circus is coming again to town. Oh, I got it here. And I'm surrounded by opposition figures, and I'm listed there as the artistic director of the opposition. That, by the way, was the day that there was violence, and people were arrested, and some of them are still in jail today. And the other photo is me allegedly campaigning for Navalny when he ran for mayor in 2013. I hope that's obviously photoshopped. I do not have hands that big. I wish I did. I'd be a much better basketball player. And then you don't need to know Russian, but just to give you a little flavor, this is the news. Yeah, turn up just a little bit.
США в России Майкла Макфола. Информированные источники из внешнеполитического ведомства сообщили прессе, что последним мероприятием посла, скорее всего, станет день 80-летия установления дипломатических отношений России и США, 16 ноября.
So the basic story here, for those who don't speak Russian, I'm being removed as ambassador because I failed to bring about the revolution. You see that I'm an expert in color revolutions. I did not have a plane like that, by the way. These are the people coming to get their instructions from me to foment the revolution. Fascists, of course, are part of this.
That's Navalny.
That's, he was just arrested last week. He was assassinated. He lives in New York. He's in exile in Estonia.
Всех их объединяло одно.
All right, you get the flavor, right?
Встречи с Майклом Макфолом и поездки к его боссам.
And then it got
того,
nasty.
Чтобы понять, кто
it got really nasty, actually, February 2012. When this video, it actually is not funny for me. I know I set you up with that other one, but this was a horrible video. This is the last slide of this video. And came out on YouTube, and luckily I have some friends at Google, and so they pulled it down. But then it appeared on other websites in Russia. To this day, if you go to Yandex and Google my name, McFaul pedophile, 3 million hits still appear. And I tell you that, one, just so you know how nasty it got, but B, how difficult disinformation is. So what do? You get on Twitter and say, I'm not a pedophile? And then you're like back and forth about arguing about a non-fact. And this is part of how this system works. But I had good company. Here's the president, and now you can laugh at this. Well, you don't know the story, because you don't read Russian. There's some people laughing over there. This is Channel 1 Kisilov, just so you know, news. Comparing, and you know, at first you may not think that Obama is the same, has the same ideology as the leader of ISIS, that's who's on the right. But if you look closer, Barack Hussein Obama actually has the same worldview, the same ideological orientation as Baghdadi. And that we could never get over. This kind of conflict, no amount of diplomacy would solve that. And then the final straw. Notice a pattern, lots of big crowds demonstrating against regimes. In this one, this is now Ukraine, we actually, and the story is Yanukovych said wouldn't sign an accession agreement to join the EU. And people in Ukraine said, we want to join the EU, and went down to demonstrate. Things got nasty. 100 of people were killed. And our goal in this was to solve the crisis. Maybe that was bad. And by the way, Ukrainians have criticized what we did at the time. But you know, Joe Biden was our main interlocutor. He was trying to cut a deal between Yanukovych and the opposition to defuse the conflict and push it down the road. February 21st, we thought we had a deal. I was in Sochi at the time, at the Olympics. My BlackBerry's blowing up. Finally, we cut a deal. It looks like everything is going to be fine, or at least for another day. But then 6 hours later, I got another email saying Yanukovych, the president of Ukraine, had appeared in Rostov, Russia. To this day, I don't exactly know why he went to Rostov. I have some theories, but it's mysterious to me. why he fled right after they had cut a deal. But for Putin, it was just a replay of the same old CIA game plan. And when he lost his guy, that's when he decided to go into Ukraine, seize Crimea, and when it was cheap, and it was too cheap in my mind, he went into eastern Ukraine to double down. And that, to me, was the end of the Cold War period and really the beginning of the hot peace. And then he went on the offensive. Rather than just responding to these things, he decided in 2016 to go on the offensive, both ideologically around the world, but even in our own election. And he's going to continue to do that, I think, for as long as he's in power. All right, I went on longer than I thought because I was telling too many Stanford stories. So I'll end on this one. So the good news, if you accept my argument, is I don't believe Putin has a master plan to recreate the Soviet Union. I see no evidence of that at all. I see a tactical, emotional guy that's willing to play his cards with more aggression than ever before. He's gotten more risky with time. That is true. But I don't see like a grand plan to recreate the Soviet Union. Nor do I see these kind of cultural or historical or balance of power arguments that would destine us to be in conflict with Russia forever. My story is one of people. Individuals matter. Power matters, but individuals matter too. Contingent outcomes matter. No demonstrators in Ukraine. Maybe our relationship is different. No demonstrators in Russia. Maybe our relationship was different. And, we're not the only actors in the world. That's one of the things I learned very clearly, that when you sit at the White House and think you control things, actually there are a lot of things you don't control. So my is much more of a contingent story. The bad news is I don't see Putin changing his view about us, because it's not about some policy tweaking. It's about something much more fundamental. He just was re-inaugurated, sworn in for another six-year term. My prediction is he's going to be there long after 2024, and the guy works out 3 hours a day. Spends the morning working out. So I think, tragically, obviously not where I want it to end in terms of U.S.-Russian relations when I was a kid going off to Leningrad in 1983, but I think, tragically, that means we need to develop a comprehensive strategy, bipartisan, can I say that 40,000 times? Bipartisan strategy for how to deal with Putin's Russia, which I think is mostly containment when we must, occasionally cooperation when we can, and sometimes we just have to not give Putin and his antics as much time and attention as we sometimes do. But if you really want to dig into all this stuff, there's only one thing you got to do, and you know what it is. And with that, I'm going to end. Thank you so much. You've been very patient. So we have about 20 minutes for questions. You've been extremely patient. So I'm going to try to be quick. I'm going to pretend we're doing Twitter answers instead of NewsHour answers. Oh, we have microphones already set up. I don't have to do anything. Great. If you could just introduce yourself and then make sure we're asking questions. If you want to give your speeches, hit me on Twitter, and I'll try to respond to that later. Please.
I'm Wynn Derman, a class of 65 at the business school.
And thank
I want to
you.
Thank
Thanks
you not
coming.
Only for your comments tonight, but for all the times I've heard you on NPR and the television programs where you provide your expertise.
Great. Thanks I for saying
I wish I
that.
Could spend 3 weeks at your feet listening to all the things that you have to say, but because I only have a limited time for a question, I want to focus a little bit on the State Department, and I'm
okay.
absolutely aghast at how they are desecrating that entire organization.
Yeah.
Are we going to see a permanent degradation of that, or can we recover?
Well, Secretary Tillerson made a mess of it. I'm sorry to be so blunt. I didn't know him personally, but I knew his company pretty well. I worked with them because they cut a big deal with Rosneft while I was working in the government. And I kept an open mind because some other people around here were more supportive of him than I was. But at the end of the day, he just didn't understand what he was doing. And it was horrible. I know lots of people, hundreds of people that work in that building. And by the way, it bothers me a little bit. So you've given me a chance to get on my soapbox a little bit. I also work with some women and men in the military serving our country overseas. I love being on the team. I just love being on the Team America with all these people. We always say, you know, thanks to the service of our men, women and men overseas in military. Well, there are women and men and women working for the State Department, working for USAID, and they are just as great Americans as those people in uniform, and they're part of the American team. And so when he went after them to cut them while we're building up the military, it's not in America's interest to do that. And I'm glad that has stopped. What I hear, I was just in D.C. a couple days ago and met with folks in the State Department, that Pompeo, the new secretary, is reversing that. And I have a lot of disagreements with Secretary Pompeo about some big policy issues. I'm nervous about, I think they made a huge mistake on Iran. I'm nervous about North Korea. But I'm glad that he's bringing that attention, because those people deserve it, especially working in Moscow. I just showed you the things that happened to me. That happened to all of my staff as well. Those people need our support. Yeah, yes. Isaac.
Hi, so I'm Isaac, I'm one of your students. So you list the Libyan intervention as one of the successes of the reset. In UN Security Council Resolution 1973, which you guys got Medvedev to support, it gives the international community permission to protect civilians. The Obama administration took it a step further and attacked Muammar Gaddafi's convoy and, you know, led to his death. Is it possible the Obama administration went too far in pushing Medvedev in this situation, and if you hadn't, he'd still be president after this decision?
Yeah, it's a good question. Good one to write your paper about. So I'd say two things. One, I want to be clear, I'm not sure that this was the moment that Putin pushed Medvedev aside. That's my speculation, right? Putin never told me that. We're not exactly Facebook friends. Actually, maybe we are Facebook friends, right? And given all the kind of trolls that are out there, he's trolling me every night. I think I'm talking to somebody. It turns out it's Putin. Who knows? And most certainly, Medvedev thought he had a shot for a second term all the way up to September. Maybe he was being delusional, but he thought he was in the game. As I used to say, Medvedev wants to run for re-election, and he just has to win one vote to win, Putin's. And his argument was, I can be the good face of Russia while you do this other stuff internally. And that's why I think Libya was a turning point, because I think Putin thought, I can't trust this guy. He doesn't understand these Americans the way I do. To your second part, yes. It was not our plan to do regime change in Libya. I want to say that emphatically. That was not our plan. Our plan was to stop Gaddafi's army from slaughtering people in Benghazi. And over the course of those, once you intervene, once you get into the mix, as my mother from Montana would say, shit happens. And that's what happened. It got out of control. We didn't kill Gaddafi, right? Let's be clear about that. We had nothing to do with his murder. We did not want it. We actually tried to work with the Russians and a guy named Mikhail Margelov, it's in the book. He was my friend, to try to figure out a way maybe we could get Gaddafi out of the country, because we were worried exactly about the scenario that eventually happened. And we even cleared airspace so that he could fly in on a government jet into Tripoli and try to negotiate that, because he knew Gaddafi. Didn't work. I'd say that about a lot of things in government. Like you have your game plan, you sit in that windowless room in the White House Situation Room, you run through 28 contingencies about what you think is going to happen, and then the point of contact of running the play, a lot of things happen that you're not prepared for. And there's no doubt that Medvedev was very disappointed in what happened. In fact, we're in Deauville, France. I remember it very vividly. He's a pretty calm, cool guy, kind of like Obama, by the way, very rational, reason, not a lot of drama. But in that meeting in Deauville, he was upset, and he felt like we had betrayed him by letting the mission creep beyond that. That's a good point. Good luck with the paper. Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Ambassador. I wondered if you could comment on the nature of Russian collaboration in the Cold War and in the hot peace. So in the Cold War, we had a Russian jewel in the crown of the CIA, Dmitry Polyakov. Mm-hmm. What is the prospect, theoretically, and what's the necessity, actually, for this type of collaboration going forward?
Spies, you mean? Most of what I know, I'm not stupid enough to talk about right now. It's called classified, and I take that very seriously. I actually got my book cleared twice, just so you know, because I was so afraid of some classified information dripping out. I wanted to make sure that didn't happen. You know, all I would say, one of the chapters in the book is called Burgers and Spies, and it talks about a spy swap that we did in 2010. Was inspirational for somebody to do this TV program called The Americans, if you watch it. So I know him. We should get some royalties for that because we did that. And I would just say then two things. One, spying is part of the business, and all countries that have the capacity to do it, do it. And we have a lot of capacity, and I'm glad we have that capacity. Russia has a lot of capacity. I wish they had less, but they have a lot of it. I'm sure they're with us right now, by the way. The first time I was read into what they could do, it was astonishing to me. And when we lived in Russia, I had to assume that every email, every phone call that I made, every movement I made in Spaso House was recorded. And if you're at any hotel in Russia, to think about where, you know, you should assume everything is recorded. That's what they can do. We even had a special room. I think this is in the book. I hope it's not confidential. I'm looking at Donna. Should I say it or not? I don't think it's confidential. Because they told you, and you didn't have a security clearance. Donna's always urging on the side of caution. But remember, they briefed us. We got there. We're going through our briefing. We're super excited. By the way, we lived in this fabulous house. Man, you know, if you ever get the chance to be ambassador anywhere, do it. But we lived in this fabulous house called Spasa House. Go look it up on the web. And I want to make clear, I've been on the negative stuff, but some of the things of being ambassador, it was awesome. I'm going to come back to my wife in a minute. I'm going to make sure I got the permission. But, here's what my J job meant. Things like, what's a good example? Oh, you know, we had a ballroom, seats 600 people, about as many people in here. My job was to invite my best friends to have Herbie Hancock play a concert in my house. That's pretty cool, right? He was a big hero of mine. My kids really loved the day we hosted the NBA at my house. That was pretty nice. And just the honor, in case I forget to say this, the honor of being your representative in Russia, the Americans' representative in Russia, President Obama's, that was just an honor of a lifetime. In fact, we got in a fight one time really early on with my bodyguards about flying the flag. You know, ambassadorial cars are usually Cadillacs, and there's a little place for the flag to be on the left-hand side, the American flag. And all this harassment stuff was going on at the time. And so my bodyguards was like, you know, Mr. Ambassador, we think we should take that flag down so we can, you know, travel around the city and people won't know who we are. And I was like, Sergey, you got to be kidding me, man. We're driving around in this giant black Cadillac with two Suburbans following us. You think they don't know I'm the U.S. ambassador? We're going to fly the flag because I'm proud to fly the flag while I'm here. The anecdote I wanted to say about the spies was, remember they briefed us? They said, if you guys need to argue, is this in the book? It's in the book. So, okay. So it got cleared by the State Department. They said to us, if ever you guys have a marital spat, we have a special room that you can do that in. Please don't do it in Spasa House, but come over and there's a special secure room that you can have your argument. And I just want to report for the record, thankfully, we never had to use that room, right? Sir.
Hi, Mike. Martin Carnoy.
Oh, I can't see out there. Yeah, good to see you. Okay.
How are you? I didn't read the book yet, but the way you...
But have you bought it?
I will.
Excellent, okay.
I want you to sign it.
I care more if you bought it than if you read it.
I was waiting for you to sign it. Okay, so the way you characterize it here, it sounds like Putin is rather one-sided, that he made a decision that he was going to go nationalist, that he was going to restore Russian prestige, et cetera. But isn't Putin a little bit, isn't there more contradictions in the whole process than that? He wants to modernize Russia, too. He wants to make Russia a really modern economy. And
no, I'm not so sure about that.
Well, he does certain things that make it seem like he wants to do things within Russia that do that. I realize his power. The way you calculate, you ended up with that it's U.S. Russian politics that are driving this, internal politics.
But, well, I got the question. Let me, because it's a good question. Because Putin is more complex than the way I described, and that's why it takes me 500 pages to tell the story. But don't be alarmed, 50 pages are footnotes, because I'm an academic. But Martin, you're right. He didn't start out here, and I talk about that in the book. When I first met him, he was working for Anatoly Sobchak, who was the democratically elected mayor of Moscow. We met in the spring of 1991. And he was working with him as part of the democratic movement at the time. When August, that coup attempt happened, he was against the coup plotters. He was not on their side. He then loses his job in St. Petersburg. This is an interesting fact that people forget, through a free and fair democratic election. Kind of cool, huh? There has to be losers in competition. Sobchak gets voted out of power. And he's looking for a job. You know, he got voted out. He's looking for a job. And one of his liberal reformer friends, not some KGB guy, Anatoly Chubais is his name, gets him a job working in the Kremlin for Boris Yeltsin, right? Think about that. The other thing I want to make sure you understand, Putin is a completely accidental president. Chosen out of nowhere in the wake of the August 1998 financial collapse. The heir apparent back then, and I write about this in the book, was actually another a person I knew well before his assassination, Boris Nemtsov. And he was a charismatic, pro-democratic, pro-liberal leader, governor. And at the height of economic depression in Russia, he managed to be reelected out in the hinterland at a time when the liberals were not very popular. By the way, Jewish and proudly Jewish. So this notion that Russians can't vote for Democrats or Jewish leaders, categorically false, he did it. And Yeltsin pulled him back, named him first deputy prime minister, and he was the heir apparent. And you don't believe me, Yeltsin said it on the record many times. In between choosing him and the presidential race, there's this financial collapse all over the world, right? August 1998, comes to Russia. So exogenous shock in the language of political science, wasn't predicted. The government has to resign. And in the wake of that, he chooses this obscure guy that was working, you know, in the Kremlin. At the time he was made prime minister in August, he had a 6% or 7% recognition rate. Most Russians could not even recognize the guy, let alone plus or minus. They didn't know who he was. Chosen, I think, mostly to protect the property rights of Yeltsin and his family, not because he was going to be some reformer. So there wasn't some societal demand for him. And so back then, to your point, he was not anti-Western as much. You know, I think his analytic framework was put in place, you know, in this KGB school, right? If you're a young man like him joining the KGB when he did, that means you have a certain political orientation, and they most certainly, you know, he didn't take poli-sci 35 with Krasner. He had a different kind of mental map of the world. But within it, it was more complex. I agree with you. And in early phases, he believed in markets. He cut taxes, 13% flat tax back then. Cut corporate taxes, was a modernizer back then, and had around him people that I consider economic modernizers as well. He's never for democracy. He shut that down as quickly as he could. But with the West and markets, he wasn't dug in. Over time, he's changed. Over time, he's become much more conservative in terms of his values. I mean, he really does believe that he is the leader of a world conservative movement, orthodox values, Christian values, family values as defined by him. And he is pushing back against the decadent liberal West. And by the way, he's achieving success. He's got allies around the world now, and he's spending billions of dollars in his platforms to propagate those ideas. Billions of dollars to do that. That took place over time. And with respect to the economy, it is a more complex story, but I think the simplified view is he didn't push for rule of law. He didn't try to guarantee the permissive conditions for investment. Instead, he redistributed the things that are worth owning. So today, there's 20% more property that's owned by the state than there was when he took over. That's not modernization, that's going backwards. And on some of the big projects that Medvedev tried to do, Skolkova, for instance, which was to try to bring investment in the high-tech world, he shied away from that. He's become more suspicious of independent economic actors, and some of them he's arrested and put in jail. A guy I used to know well just ended up in jail a month ago. Victor Vexelberg, who's been in the news a lot lately. Well, you're not reading the Russian news because in Russia, he's also in trouble. He's had a couple of his people arrested by Putin there. So think about how bad his life is. He's the government of America has sanctioned him. They're arresting his people in Russia, and Mueller's after him. That's a bad troika. But it's a great point. It wasn't inevitable that it would happen this way. And even between 2012 and 2014, period, I was ambassador, there were some pockets of cooperation with him. We did the Syria chemical weapons deal with him during that time. That's when they signed the Rosneft ExxonMobil deal. I think annexation, that's when he finally said, okay, I've had it with these Americans. I don't care what they do. I don't want to join their clubs. We're gonna go our different way. Over here.
Thanks. My name is Margaret Williams.
Hey, good to see you.
I'm a second-year master's student here.
Yeah.
I'm wondering if you could talk a little about the role of American public opinion or perception in U.S.-Russian relations. You know, during the Cold War, you mentioned as a high school student in Montana, you feared the tension between our two countries. Your mom saw the Soviet Union as an evil empire. Today, that more or less consensus, I don't think it exists. I think even our own president, sometimes you're not sure if he sees Putin as a friend or
right.
an adversary.
Right.
How does that impact U.S. foreign policy? And how does that impact President Putin's ability to carry out his ideological campaign against the West?
Yeah, Margaret, that's a big, hard question. And you're not writing a term paper for me. That sounds like a good thesis. I don't have a soundbite answer to that. I do know that there is a causal relationship, which is to say when societal attitudes are in a more positive way, it gives you more freedom to maneuver in terms of more audacious things. And when it's more negative, it constrains you. When I was in the government, were oftentimes constrained by, the Republicans in Congress, certain things they would not let us do. Missile defense cooperation, for instance, and I have a chapter on it in the book, we had a pretty ambitious plan to try to cooperate with them. And those that were more suspicious of Russia, this is still the Medvedev days, were suspicious of that cooperation. In fact, we spent some quality months in the Marriott Execuste, waiting to go to Moscow, quality months with my family, I mean, because we thought we were gonna be on our way, but there was a hold put on my nomination. And the leader of it was Mark Kirk, Senator Mark Kirk from Illinois, Republican. And he said to me, well, the first meeting went pretty bad. I went in, I'm doing the rounds, and my handler at the time was a guy, Dennis McDonough, who later becomes the chief of staff. He says, your job is just to sit and say, that's a very interesting question. I look forward to getting back to you on that, right? That's what I was coached to do. And I went in, I don't want to put words in his mouth, but he basically said, your boss is a traitor and I can't trust him. And I kind of pushed back, and the meeting lasts 45 seconds. And he said, I think we're done here. And I called Dennis. I said, Dennis, the meeting only lasted 45 seconds. That's probably not a good sign. He said, yeah, you screwed that one up, McFaul. But I got my shot again, and I later made peace with Senator Kirk. But the point I'm trying to make is there was a domestic political constraint on what we could do. And he later got his amendment to the National Defense Authorization Act that required us to give the Senate information before we would give it to the Russians. That was going to be a check on them, and that was the quid pro quo for getting the lifts off of my, to me. Putin, I think, has a different problem. Putin today has, you know, the numbers now are like negative 80, right, in terms of how Russians think of us. They've told this story now for several years that they've been fighting a war against us. Nazis and NATO, right? That's the two N-words we used to call it in the embassy. And, you know, the war in Ukraine is not with Ukrainians, it's with us. That's the way it's portrayed. And that's had a rallying around the flag effect, as it does all over the world. But that means it's pretty hard to pivot away from that and to say we're in this Manichaean struggle against Nazis and American imperialism, and all of a sudden now we're going to move the other way. He can, of course, do it because it's not a democratic society, but I do think it creates constraints. And secondly, there's a group around him that, that don't have an interest in cooperation with us. They like this isolation. That's a way for them to keep their property rights. They don't want competition in the market. They prefer to be isolated. And that's another set of interest groups that also put pressure on him. And I think occasionally, I can't prove this, but I think occasionally do audacious things, and sometimes even abroad, not ordered by Putin, but as a way to kind of keep him captive in this confrontational relationship with us. Yeah.
Hey, last, Professor.
How about last two questions, okay, and we'll be done, right? Catherine just gave me the signal.
Great.
Last three, you've been sitting there patiently. And here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to take them all together and then I'll conclude. Is that okay? Okay. You're the authority here, not me. All right, I'll take them all three and then we'll end. Yeah, first.
Okay,
yeah.
Great. I'm Mackenzie. I'm a student in your class.
Yes.
sorry, that was not for you, for everyone else. He knows who I am.
You got a piece of paper so I can write him down? Thanks.
So my question was, I was really struck by the story you told of Putin's reaction to the 2011 gathering of mostly young people, this idea of these kids,
yeah,
and Putin's reaction and this idea of anger in that, you know, I made them rich.
Yes.
And I was wondering, can you speak to any other elements where you think that Putin actually has felt betrayed or didn't get credit for the things that he thought he actually was doing for the Russian people?
Good question. Okay. Over here. Yeah.
My name is Anna.
Hey, Anna.
Master's student. So
from Russia, by the way.
Yeah. But my question is more about the process of writing a book.
Oh, okay.
So
it's hard.
Yeah.
I've been on these interviews over the last week. They all say, oh, you're labor of love. And I've said, no, it's labor. There's no love involved. Sorry.
But probably it gets even harder when you're writing a book during the period of time when Russia-American relations deteriorate faster and faster.
Yes.
So I was wondering whether that... I would imagine that that would give you kind of an urge to go back and to rewrite something or add something or edit something as a reaction, like subliminal reaction to what is happening. Was this the case? And maybe you can share some examples.
Okay, good. Yeah.
Hi, Ambassador. I appreciate the comments tonight. Got some great insight from you. My question is about the recent appointment of the Prime Minister of Russia, Dmitry Medvedev. Why was he reappointed as prime minister? What does it mean for Russia? What does it mean about Putin's worldview? Thanks.
Great. Great last questions. I'm going to take them in a little bit different order so I can end where I want to end. So on Medvedev, you know, there are lots of rumors about who is going to be the next prime minister and a lot of hope among the business community, both the American and Russian, that there was going to be a new reformer, you know, back to the conversation we had with Martin. And Kudrin, his former finance minister, was one of the names floated. German Greff, who runs the Bear Bank, his name was floating. And the fact that he went back to Medvedev and he didn't choose those other guys, and Kudrin, they thought was going to get a big job, and it was just announced today he's going to have a pretty small job running the audit chamber, not exactly being prime minister, suggests to me that continuity and stability is more important to Putin than trying to pivot in this more liberal course. And some of the people he fired were also some of the more pro-Western people. So that those are not optimistic signs. And don't take my word for it. The American business community, they had a lot of optimism that this was going to be a moment for change. I just saw many of them last week, and they're pretty despondent by that choice. Second, Mackenzie's question. It's a good question. I think for him, I left out, and where'd you go? I just saw, okay. I think he has a legitimate complaint is after September 11th, he was one of the first leaders to call the White House. He actually got Condi first, but he later talked to President Bush. And he saw this was a moment where we had a common enemy, terrorists, and he leaned in. And he had experienced terrorists in his country. And he said, I'm going to do whatever I can to help you. And back then, not everybody supported him to do that. And he did several things that were important, helping us with the Northern Alliance, for instance, their allies that later became our allies. He cooperated with us. Opening up that base Manas that I mentioned, that happened with Putin putting pressure on the Kyrgyz government and the Uzbek government to open up those bases to cooperate with us. And I think the fact that we were with him then and then kind of forgot about his assistance, that's a chip on his shoulder, and he told President Obama about it in that same photo that I showed you. But I think that's legitimate. And had we cooperated more closely with them on that, even on Iraq, he kind of intimated, you know, if you treated me as a partner instead of just telling me what to do, I might have even been able to go along with you on that. So that's fair. I think it's an overstatement, however, you give me a chance to say this, to claim that he's the one that brought economic growth to Russia. That's just not true. The economic reforms, the painful economic reforms that were put in place over the 90s, including the last year and a half by liberal reformers, that was the precondition to it. And by the way, all post-communist countries went through this period of economic depression, nothing unusual or different for Russia. And then they started to grow the year before Putin came back. So growth had turned around before he came back. And then right as he appeared, oil prices, you know, skyrocketed. Oil and gas prices skyrocketed. And a former colleague of mine, Yegor Gaidar, who was the first deputy prime minister, took over, was the first reformer. He used to joke, anybody can look like an economic genius when the price of a barrel of oil is $100. I was prime minister when it was at $9. So think about that. So if it happens on your watch, you get credit for it, but it would have happened to whoever was there. If Boris Nemtsov had been president at that time, it would have happened on his watch. He would have got credit for it. Last one, things I would have done differently in terms of this story. You know, I didn't want to, there's an epilogue in the book, Anna, I don't see where you're at. Way in the back, oh wow, I can barely see you. I didn't even want to write, the epilogue's called Trump Putin. I didn't want to write it. My publishers thought it was a good idea to include it. Helped with, you know, allowing me to be on Anderson Cooper and Jake Tapper today. Without that epilogue, maybe I wouldn't be on there. But I didn't want to write that because that story's too contingent and will be out of date. And it already is in some ways out of date. But there is one part, as I looked at it, you know, flying back here the other day, that I do kind of regret. And I would have changed it. I got it right, but I would have, you know, you asked me what I'd do different. This is what I would do different. I started this talk saying this is a tragedy, right? Tragedy in U.S.-Russian relations, Obama administration, myself, and we should be judged by our results, right? Not our intentions. It doesn't matter if you tried really hard playing basketball. If you lose the game, you lose the game. It's in the loss column, right? So no A's for effort in international diplomacy, as far as I'm concerned. But I'm not as pessimistic as the end of the book might sound. And this is a good place to end. First of all, I love Russia. I love Russians. And just because I disagree with the policies of the person who's in the Kremlin, I'm not going to allow those people to deny me that right to continue to love Russians and Russia. And it happens to me. I'm being attacked all the time now for this book. Oh, Russiaphobe, you know, hates Russia, cold warrior. I'm not. And I wish I would have spent a little more time making that clear. Just as Americans, we can criticize Donald Trump. That doesn't mean we don't love America. Give me a break. And I wish I would have made that clear. The second thing, I'm an optimist about Russia. I'm an optimist about U.S.-Russian relations. Maybe I'm an optimist in general, right? You know, Montanans tend to be. So maybe that's just because I was born in Montana. It has nothing to do with, like, being, you know, analyzing things. But I'm an optimist for two reasons. I mean, I'm an optimist for all kinds of reasons, but I want to end with two anecdotes. One, noodlehead professor from Stanford, and two, anecdote from being ambassador. So as a professor, and I'm sure some of you have taken Frank Fukuyama's class, you know that there's a theory that is very robust. It's called modernization theory. And the more well-to-do a society is, the more likely it is to become democratic. And that has happened over the last couple hundred years, fits and starts, comes and goes. It's not an even line, and we don't really know how it gets going. But I don't think Russia's going to buck that trend. Russia is moving in that direction. They're becoming more well-to-do. And there's no accident that the wealthiest, most educated, most urban people are also the ones that are protesting. That is a trend you see all over the world. There's nothing Russian about that. We've seen it in Taiwan. We've seen it in Korea. We've seen it all over the globe. It's waning now because of, you know, democracy's not doing well. But I don't see Russia escaping those kind of structural conditions, right? But then I want to end with an anecdote. I was at a high-tech company. That's part of your job, right? You go around and you meet people. And I met lots of people, lots of Russians. You'd be surprised how many oligarchs I know. Kaspersky, have you heard of him? I used to go see him. He's in a lot of trouble right now. Deripaska, have you heard of him? He's in a lot of trouble right now. He's in a lot of trouble. Nobody's in more trouble than he is. When people say sanctions don't matter, call Oleg. Sanctions matter. He's in a lot of trouble. But anyway, I was at some high-tech company. It was right after that May 6th demonstration poster that I showed you, right? Or sometime after. And I asked people in the audience. You know, it felt like a typical Silicon Valley scene, right? And they looked like Silicon Valley engineers. And I said, how many of you were at that protest? They all raised their hand. All raised their hand. They were all there. Creative class, right? Kreativny class. And then there was another one coming. And I said, well, how many of you plan to go to that? And only three people raised their hand. All young men. And I must have reacted to it, right? I must have pulled back or something, because a young woman saw my reaction, and she said, Mr. Ambassador, I didn't raise my hand. I have two kids. I'm the breadwinner. My no-good-for-nothing husband, he couldn't take care of my kids if I got arrested. She didn't say exactly that, but she kind of hinted at that. I can't go to jail right now. I got to show up to work to pay for my family. But don't think for a minute that I've changed my preferences about this regime. So I'm not going to demonstrate tomorrow. And she probably didn't demonstrate last week when people were being arrested. But I think we make a big mistake if we think that Putin's got this whole society locked up and they want to be on this Putinism path for many, many years. I actually don't think he's put the institutions in place for Putinism to survive his tenure. There's no party there. There's no organization. It all depends on the one leader. And so I do think there will be change coming. And it'll be a fight. It won't be clear whether those liberal people working for a high-tech company will succeed or the more nationalists will succeed. But, you know, just last week, 85 people arrested in Yakutsk, not Moscow, St. Petersburg, and 12-year-olds. Think about that. 12-year-olds were arrested just last week. You arrest a 12-year-old for protesting, you know, Article 31 of the Constitution, it's a constitutional right. You think he's ever going to vote for Putin? Do you think they're ever going to go to his side? And so, you know, in the long run, I am an incredibly optimistic about Russia's future and therefore the future of U.S.-Russia relations. I just don't know when that long run begins. Thank you all. You've been great.
So thank you all very much. Thank you, Michael. I have a feeling if you want to buy the book, you can do so on your way out. And I believe Mike is going to stay around for a bit up there outside, and we'll sign a book for you, too, if you'd like. Thank you very much.